Hi, everyone. Welcome back. Thank you for being here. Our next speaker is Álvaro, who will be talking about something very specific, as he mentioned, very niche, apparently. So please give him a warm welcome.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. It's my second time in HipCon in Belgrade. So my name is Álvaro Sánchez. I'm a software developer, a Java developer, working on, currently I'm working on Micronaut. I'm a committer on the project. I work for Oracle. Oracle is sponsoring this, this project. I'm not a developer advocate myself, but I enjoy going to conferences and try to share my knowledge. On a personal level, you can see I have two kids, so not so many free time. I'm a runner. I'm sure you will be surprised, but I'm a runner. I run a lot. I run containers, I run applications, I run databases. So enough about me. So this session is about Micronaut Kubernetes operators. So let me ask a few questions, although I don't see much. So who's a Java developer? Yeah, almost everybody. Who's a Go developer? Yeah, OK, sorry about that. Who is, for those using Java, so who's using Spring Boot or Quarkus? Yes, you can leave the room, thank you. Who's using Micronaut? Yeah, we have one user, yeah. Okay, and who's running Kubernetes in production? And who's happy with that? okay, yes, that's fine. This session is about implementing Kubernetes operators in Java, and those who are into the Kubernetes, they know that you know, the Kubernetes world is mostly about Go, because Kubernetes itself is written in Go. Everything looks like has to be done in Go, but I have something to say. Please don't Go. Please don't go. It doesn't necessarily have to be Go. There are operator SDKs in all the major languages. There are client SDKs in all the major languages, including Java. And actually, the Java client for Kubernetes is maintained by the Kubernetes project itself. So it's like the official one. There is like another one for Java. You can take a picture of those QR codes, like the slides and the demos. Let me give you a brief introduction about Micronaut. So there's three things I would like you to get from this presentation about Micronaut. So Micronaut is modern Java framework. And by modern, I mean it's not designed in year 2000 as like your favorite popular Java framework in the market. But we started in 2017 thinking on the type of applications that were created like now, like microservices, REST APIs, serverless functions, etc. It's a general purpose framework. You can use it for anything you want. People typically use it for you know, REST APIs, but you can have message-driven, like a Kafka consumer or producer, command line application, serverless function, etc. You name it. And performance. Performance is really important for us. We strive every day, in every release, to make the framework faster and consume less resources. And the way we do that is through something called health time compilation. So we leverage a Java facility that has existed in Java for years, which is called a annotation processing tool, APT. apt is a compiler hook to essentially react to annotations present on the source code during compilation, which means that we are able to generate all the framework infrastructure at compile time. If you compare that to Spring or Jakarta E, they do crazy things at runtime, like class path scanning. They do dynamic proxy generation, dynamic class loading. They use reflection, and everything, all of that is really slow and consumes a lot of memory, so we don't do any of that. Like I said, it's a general purpose framework. In terms of history, we started 6 years ago. We are at the version 4 nowadays. I will skip a bit like the details, but this is like a hello world, so it's an annotation-based programming model, so that's coming from Spring and feel like at home. We have all the goodies, like for example, like a declarative HTTP client, which is going to be implemented at compile time. So all the annotations that are part of the framework will be generated, the code is going to be generated at compile time, whereas other frameworks will do that at runtime. For messaging, we support the major technologies. Same for data access. We have Micronaut data that uses the repository pattern that you may be familiar with already. But again, the difference is that everything is compile time. We have compile time checks. If you make a typo, you get a compilation error, etc. In terms of security, all the major technologies are supported, and there's much more things. So I don't want to spend more time on this. You can get started with a website, which is launch.micronaut.io, where you select the type of features that you want, and we will generate like a skeleton application. Or use a command line, or use an IntelliJ wizard, or a Visual Studio Code extension. So now let's talk about the specific support for running Micronaut applications in or on Kubernetes. So obviously, Micronaut is a general purpose Java framework. So you can, of course, without any Kubernetes support, you can deploy any Java application to Kubernetes. That's no secret. So you will have like the typical runnable jar that will listen on port 8080. So you put it into Docker image, you push this image to registry, and then you create a Kubernetes manifest, and then create like a deployment for this image, and then expose it as a service. That will all work, right? But you're missing some of the benefits of using a framework, right? So we're here to help, and there are a few things in addition to that you can benefit from. One is service discovery. So service discovery is, generally speaking, the ability when you have a microservice architecture, or essentially when you have like a HTTP client and server applications that need to communicate, or you have one service that needs to query an external API. Whenever you have HTTP communications, service discovery is the ability to actually be able to tell in which URL, which ports are listening those services. So in this case, imagine you have two Kubernetes services deployed in your cluster. And imagine, like for example, there's one that has multiple replicas, so there are more than one instance. You can create the HTTP client like this. So you specify the service name, which will match the Kubernetes service name. And this works by default because all Kubernetes clusters will run a core DNS service. So the service name is actually a DNS entry that will resolve to the pod IP, right? So this works. But you still have to provide like the port. And if it's could be that the service is listening HTTPS and you don't know, so it will fail. So you have to specify that, which is not convenient. So the alternative is using the Micronaut integration for Kubernetes, in which case you only specify the service ID and you forget about the rest. So internally, what we do is we query the Kubernetes API and we're able to tell, okay, what is my service resolving to? Well, this is the detail, so we can get this information from the endpoints, from the Kubernetes endpoints, or from the Kubernetes service. If there is like multiple replicas, instead of trusting DNS round robin, so for example, when you use my service as the host, and there are multiple replicas, you theoretically will have DNS round robin across all the cluster IPs of the target, right? But DNS fails sometimes, right? So you will get some resolution issues. So we don't do that. What we do is we internally round robin to the target IPs, and it's constantly updated. So you have like new replicas coming in. The number of target services will grow or shrink too much what is happening in reality. Another thing that you get with integration is distributed configuration. So the idea with distributed configuration is that in Micronaut, like in most Java frameworks, you can read, like the configuration values can come from multiple places. So you can have properties files or a YAML file, right? That's like the default. But you can have configuration coming from environment variables or command line flags. When you use the Micronaut Kubernetes integration, there is an additional source for properties, which is the config maps or a secret. And this is really useful because it will, you know, on the fly, it will allow you to have dynamic configuration that your application can read from. And that's what the demo is about. So in this case, we have a secret on the left with a couple of properties. And if you are using the integration, what Micronaut will do internally is to convert those properties, will essentially read those properties and make them available for you to read them with any of the ways that you can read properties in Micronaut. One is using the add value annotation, which you may know from Spring, but there are other things. So you could create like a configuration properties class, etc. Right? In this case, for example, if you want to give permissions to your application to read config maps or secrets, you can mount them as volumes. In which case, the Kubernetes controller will actually create files for those secrets, and we will read the files, so no API access is required. So far, so good. Yeah, blink if it's okay. Yeah, thank you. Another thing that you get is health checks. So Micronaut has a management management module. The management module it's what it's called the actuator module in Spring Boot. The management module has endpoints, one of which is the health endpoint. The health endpoint is really crucial when you're running into Kubernetes. Why? Because Kubernetes has this notion of a liveness check and health check, right? It will actually use your provided health endpoint to tell if your application is ready, is up or not, and if it's up, if it's ready to be serving requests or not, right? So normally you are responsible to tell how to get the health of your application. So has my application healthy or not? Well, if I'm using a database, for example, my application is healthy. If it can connect to the database, if the database connection is failing, then my application isn't healthy. And this is like the detailed view that you can get from the health endpoint. So when you are using the Micronaut integration with Kubernetes, you get additional information. Like, for example, we prove the communication with the Kubernetes API. We tell you additional details about where is the application running. We resolved all the services that are discovered and in which different endpoints. So this is an example where you can see that the Micronaut HTTP client will run Robin through those different IPs ports. Another thing that you get is a seamless integration with the Kubernetes Java client. So in terms of Java, there are two major Java libraries for working with the Kubernetes API. One is the official Kubernetes client, and it's called official because it's maintained by the Kubernetes project itself. And the other one is the fabricate Kubernetes client. They are like different in a way that the official one is guaranteed to be always up to date because it's generated from the Kubernetes Open API spec. So they make sure that whenever there is like a new major release of Kubernetes and there are like new types, they regenerate the client again, they publish a new version. So it's always up to date. And to use the official Kubernetes client, you'll have to, like in a raw Java application with no framework, you will have to create an instance of a class and then create the underlying HTTP client library. You will have to tell how to read the kubeconfig, et cetera. When you use the Micronaut integration, we do that for you, so that you don't have to worry. You can simply use dependency injection, right? You can use dependency injection to use those objects, and you have a configurable HTTP client under the covers. The Kubernetes authentication is using the defaults, but you can point it to a different kubeconfig or whatever. And also everything via configuration, so you don't have to worry about that. And finally comes the operator support. So who knows what is a Kubernetes operator? Three hands, yeah, okay, yeah. Let me explain. Like, forget about this session for a moment. Putting my hat of Kubernetes instructor. So an operator is a daemon running on the cluster that will react to events happening on a cluster, right? That's like the formal definition of a Kubernetes operator. And you probably don't know what a Kubernetes operator is, but you've seen them or you've used them, surely. And I'll give you one example. When you use kubectl to create a deployment, right? What's happening there? So what happens is that kubectl is a REST client for the Kubernetes API server, right? And you create an object on the Kubernetes API, on the etcd storage or whatever it is. But that is not sufficient to actually have a pod being created, a container image being pulled and run, etc., right? So what happens is the cluster has an operator running, which will react to those services being created, and will say, okay, so this guy wants to create a service. Let's see how the service it is. Sorry, it's a deployment. Deployment has a this image with this replica, so I need to create these pods with these instances, blah, blah, blah. It will make sure that constantly in a loop, it will make sure that the actual state matches what you have been providing with YAML configuration. Yeah? So far, so good. That's an operator. Now, the thing is, what would you want to create an operator like for your project, your product? And there are multiple reasons for this. So you want to, you may want to use operator building blocks to react to certain things that are happening in a cluster. So go back to the distributed configuration example. In that case, it could be a way for you to have like dynamic configuration. So, because for example, if you have like properties, like a properties file or a YAML file in your application, you ship it into the jar file. Once you ship it into the jar file, there's no way to change that, right? So then you could use, like, for example, environment variables. But environment variables are only read when the application is starting. Changing an environment variable while the while the pod is running is not going to take any effect. So one thing you can do is create a config map or read the configuration from a config map. And a config map is something that you can change while the application is running. And you can tell your application to react to those events. So you can tell, OK, if this config map is changed, then I will process something or do whatever. Now, in the case of config maps, Microsoft by default will watch config map events. Actually, not by default, you have to enable. But if you enable, we take care of, like, constantly watch the certain config maps. We will do label matching. And then we'll make all of those configurations available to your application without any restart required. But you can react to not only config maps, but any kind, including custom resources. So there's three building blocks that Micronaut will help you to work with. One is an informer. An informer is essentially like a simple callback mechanism to react when a certain Kubernetes object type has been created, updated, or deleted. Right? This is really simple. This requires a lot of plumbing under the covers to make it work. But for you as a user, it is as simple as this. So you create a class. I use the annotation. In this case, I want to react to config map events, but you could react to any other thing. And then you just implement the method bodies, and that's it. So that will work. That's an informer. And then the second building block is something a bit more advanced, which is a reconciler. So a reconciler is a piece that will have to provide a reconciling loop. It's an infinite loop in which you check that the actual state of the cluster is matching the configuration, the YAML configuration. Okay. So if we go back to the pod controller. The pod controller will make sure that if you have like three objects of kind pod with one replica each, it will make sure that it will create those pods, those containers, etc., for you. And we'll react when something is deleted or updated, because you can live edit a deployment and say, OK, I want more replicas or less replicas, et cetera, right? I'm going to skip this section. The only thing I'm going to mention to you is there is a website named graal.cloud. Graal is a brand, an umbrella brand for three projects under Oracle. One is GraalVM, which is probably what you have heard about already. Another one is Graal Cloud Native, which is a micro distribution built by Oracle for companies that are not allowed to get dependencies from public repositories. And another one is Graal OS, which is a serverless platform that uses Micronaut and GraalVM for writing functions in Java. GraalVM is probably something you've heard about. So who's heard about GraalVM before? Yeah, very few people. So GraalVM is an OpenJDK distribution that allows you not only to run your applications as if it were any other regular JDK, but also it allows you to use the native image component to create a native executable of your application. A native executable matters because startup time is several orders of magnitude faster. Resource utilization is much lower, so memory consumption is normally 10%, like memory footprint. It minimizes vulnerability because while in the process of creating this native executable, what GraalVM does is it will traverse all your source code and will compile it to native code, like machine code for that operating system. And in the process of doing so, it will create like a graph of what is reachable and what is unreachable. So imagine, like for example, you have like this common slang like a jar file with all of their dependencies, but at the end of the day, you're using like a one method from the string utils class, which is a waste, right? So what GraalVM will do is all the classes that are not used from commonslang will not be on the native executable. So therefore, the surface attack for your application is smaller, and you're subject to less vulnerabilities. And you have like a single binary that you can distribute. The combination of Micronaut and GraalVM is unique because it will give you the fastest startup time and the lowest memory consumption. And this is a comparison between like all the four major Java frameworks. This benchmark has been run for by Matt Rabel. Matt Rabel is a developer advocate at Okta. He's regularly doing this benchmark comparison between all the major Java frameworks, and Micronaut is consistently the fastest. So this is milliseconds in development mode, like run up locally, and then native mode, when you run the native image, you can see it's a fraction of that. There is a use case which is worth to mention, and it's Disney Plus. Disney Plus is using Micronaut and GraalVM for serverless function on AWS Lambda. I recommend you to read about that. So they came to the conclusion that in a serverless scenario, you know, having a function that starts so quickly is really cost saving, because in Lambda, the less time you run your function, the less money you pay. That's applicable for the cloud in general. And now the demo. Well, actually, I have like an explanation of what we're gonna see. So for this demo, I like imagined like a new product, which I named ABCDB, because well, it's an imaginary product. That imagine you're like a product company, and as a product company, imagine you're creating like a new cool database. There are multiple ways you can distribute this to your customers. You can like for example give them a jar file, right? Give them a jar file, and they will figure out how to add configuration for it and how to put it into a container, etc. The next level is, okay, I will give you like a Docker image, right? I give you a Docker image, you can run the Docker image, but I still have to provide configuration options, blah, blah, blah. So the next level is, okay, I'll give you, for example, a Helm chart, right? And in Helm, you take care of not only the deployment, the service, but you provide config maps and like configuration options to customize this image. And then there is like another level where you say, okay, on top of all those options, because you need to give them all to, because not everybody is willing to adopt only one. So there's people more comfortable with just the Docker image, and then give me the Docker image and I will craft the Kubernetes manifest and I will deploy it myself. And there are others that say, okay, I just want a Helm chart and we'll install the Helm chart and we're done with it. The last one is providing an operator. So you create an operator, they install the operator on their cluster, and they manage your product using a custom resource in Kubernetes, right? And this custom resource has all the configuration. So based on this custom resource in Kubernetes, you basically deploy, configure your application accordingly, and they don't have to worry about. So what we're going to have is a couple of things. So this is like the blue dots line is like the Kubernetes cluster. And in the Kubernetes cluster, we have this ABCDB operator. The operator is running, right? It's running already. And the operator will reconcile objects of type ABCDB. So when one comes in, it will create a config map, a deployment, and a service, and a pod with the running application. Okay? Can I have like 5 more minutes? Yeah, thank you. So, on one hand, we have the product that we are going to manage, and this is an empty application with a simple Hello World controller that will, sorry, 1 second. Yeah, much better. That will display one message. Now, this message is coming from one configuration key, which is a bcdb.message. And what you hear here is like the default message. So if there's no value provided for this configuration key, this is the message that will be displayed. And then this application is aware if it's running in Kubernetes, right? Which is this branch of Dave here. So if it's running in Kubernetes, it will display this message. And if it's not, it will display this other one. So for example, in this case, if I go to terminal here, I can, like for example, run this application. And if the demo gods are with me, yeah, we have the application. And then we can open another terminal and say curl 0.8080. It's displaying the default message, and it's running outside Kubernetes, OK? I think I have here, which is this is build mail what mail distributions ABCDB. No, I don't have any image, so never mind. Anyway, now the next thing I'm going to show you is 1 second. Stop it, leave me alone. It's this my ABCDB, right? This is the custom resource that our operator will react to, right? As you can see, it looks like a core Kubernetes object, but in this case, the kind is different. And then I'll show you later the operator code, but it's not really important. So imagine my database has 1 million configuration parameters to be working with. In my example, I only have a message to be configured. So this is what the application should be displayed when it's configured by the operator, right? So now let's go to the terminal and let's run this and see what happens. So top left here, we have a continuous watch over the Kubernetes resources. The namespace where this is going to be created, so everything is empty. Bottom left, we have a continuous curl to the application. Since it's not running, there's no application being deployed, and then connection is failed. So now if I do, I apply this my ABCDB, right? You can see that instantly, it's really fast, the operator has created like a config map, a deployment, and a service. Right? See how fast it is? And this is the message. We have it. Hello from Nasir. They're running in a Kubernetes cluster. So it's aware that it's running on Kubernetes. So let's edit this. This is the, I'm not editing the config map, but I'm editing the ABCDB object, to be clear. And the operator will say, OK, this has changed, so I need to update the config map. So let's change the message. It's probably two. Oops. Hello, hipcom. Rakia is great. And we save it. Look at the bottom left part. A message is changed instantly. The application wasn't changed. It's been running all the time. And the way this happened is because it's like if we open up the controller, this controller is refreshable. Refreshable means that Micronaut will refresh the bin when like a refresh event is being created, and changing the configuration triggers a refresh event. The other thing I want to show you is the operator. So it's a ABCDB operator. You can see like the code on GitHub that I shared at the beginning, but it's essentially a loop, an infinite loop, in which you basically say, okay, so if there is like a new ABCDB being created, then and this object is being deleted, then I will delete all the objects. Otherwise, I will create or update them. And this is using the Kubernetes API under the covers. So it's not really important. Another thing that I want to show here is that if I delete this thing, it will remove all the things as well. That's part of the operator job, to clean the state, right? It's idempotent. We have some time for questions. I don't know how much, but in the meantime, how much? One question? Yeah. There's a cure code with a simple feedback form for me. It's like a simple star rating. I really appreciate if you give me feedback. It's beneficial for me. My boss is not going to fire me or like give me a raise if it's it's only for me. And do we have any question here? There are so many questions, or you're taking a picture. Okay, so if we don't have any questions, only two things to ask you. So did you learn something new today? Yeah? Did you have fun? Thank you very much. You're wonderful.